routine, and I actually execute the instructions in that subroutine in this main program with this call statement. So external to this main program is maybe a subroutine definition like this, where this right here is your subroutine, and here is where it gets executed. Well, in the Verilog program, going to have a module, and this is sometimes called a template. Or module template. And then in some other module, let's call this module food. In some other module, it's where it would be instantiated. So this is a module template. This is defining what the block does. But it's down here where it gets instantiated, where the module is actually created as part of a design. So it's analogous to what we had in C over here when we're talking about a main calling routine and a subroutine. This is the subroutine definition. Here's where it gets executed. This module template is where we define what a block of code will do, what a circuit will do. And down here, we actually take that circuit and make it part of the design. Okay, and we'll see many, many examples of this. Okay, let me show you a detailed example now. Remember that design we talked about last time, the ripple counter, where we had four T flip-flops, and then the T flip-flop was composed of a inverter and a D flip-flop. This is a block of actual synthesizable Verilog code. And I'm not going to explain the semantics of the instruction, but I just want to point some things out down here. Here I have a module T under bar FF, so I have module and module, so that's defining a module. And then here, this is the module template. This is what I'm telling you what a D flip-flop does. Oh, I'm sorry, what a T flip-flop does. Up here, in this module, what I'm doing is I'm actually creating my ripple counter. Now I need four T flip-flops. So you see that there is an instantiation of four instances of a T flip-flop, and that's how I would construct my
Do you not have to put something for, like, I noticed you've instantiated before you've defined it, you don't have to put something up above so that it knows what you're talking about before?
Oh, okay, that's a good question. If you look at this, and this is unique to Verilog, you don't have to declare something before it's used. In a C program, for example, if I'm declaring my variables, I have to declare a variable before I use it in some mathematical statement. That's not true in Verilog. Here I've got declarations of signals, and then down here I use them. I could take these declarations and put them down here. Similarly, this entire template routine could be anywhere. It does not have to be above in the code before the place where it's actually instantiated. And that's unique to Verilog. it's kind of order independent in that regard. And incidentally, that's a point I'm going to make when we start looking at gate level modeling, which is something that we'll start on today. All right, so let's talk in general about programming languages. All programming languages have the following: an alphabet, syntax, and semantics. And I don't care if you're talking about C programs or Python or Java or Verilog. They all have these three components: alphabet, syntax, and semantics. The alphabet tells you what characters are allowed in program statements. And in the C programming language, I can have lowercase letters, I can have uppercase letters, and I can have special symbols. Comma, a period, a pound sign, a forward slash, a backslash, and so on. So these are the characters that I can use to construct program statements. The syntax tells you how to combine alphabet characters into valid statements. So these are the characters that I can use to construct statements. And syntax gives me the rules on what is valid and what's not valid as far as constructing a statement. For example, in C, I can do I plus plus semicolon. So I've got a lowercase letter, two plus signs, and a semicolon. And it says that this is the is syntactically correct. The syntax says I cannot do this. I've got the same characters, different order. This is okay, and that one's not. Okay, so syntax will give you those rules. Then the semantics is the meaning or interpretation. Of a syntactically correct statement. semantics of this syntactically correct statement is you take the current value of I and you increment it by one. This doesn't have any semantics because it's a meaningless statement. It's not syntactically correct. So when we talk about semantics, we're only talking about statements that have complied with the syntax rules. Verilog also has an alphabet. In fact, it's the same alphabet as C. It has a syntax, and we're going to see that the syntax of Verilog statements is very similar in many respects to what you encountered in C. And the semantics of that will also be surprisingly similar to what you encountered in C. What I'm covering right now is just general properties of the Verilog programming language. A little bit later in today's lecture, we're going to start looking at some actual valid code that we can use to describe designs, at least at the gate level. So in Verilog, you should have complemented code. And this is very similar to what you found in C++. That is the syntax for doing a multi-line comment. That's how you do a single line comment. The second thing is in Verilog, when it comes to operators, I will have three types. Unary, binary, and ternary. Unary only have a single parameter that you're actually operating on. So an example of that would be A equals not B. So I'm taking this value of B, taking the complement of it, and setting it equal to A. So I only need one element to operate on. Binary requires two. And there's a simple example, Y equals A plus B. I need two operators. I need two elements to operate on, an A and a B. And then ternary. Everybody want to hazard a guess as to what the semantics of that statement are? Yeah.
So it says if B is true, then set C, if not, set the D.
Okay, that is the one line if then else statement in C. It's also the one line if then else statement in Verilog. Okay, so this requires three objects to operate on. Now for something completely different. representing numbers. Well, I could always represent a number like 22, decimal number. But in digital circuits, we're dealing with numbers that are represented by binary strings. So I need to represent numbers as binary strings or equivalently hexadecimal characters. So for numbers, specifically binary or hexadecimal numbers, here's your syntax. So this is going to be your size in bits. This is your base, which can be B or capital B. It doesn't matter if you use lowercase or uppercase B. This will be for binary, decimal, and hex, respectively. And then this would be the value. Let me give you some examples. Four-bit binary, all ones. Without that, you wouldn't know how to interpret this particular number, because that would not be the same as what would I put out here? This is the size in bits. You have a four-character hexadecimal string, so the size would be 16 bits. Now,
does it mean the little apostrophe?
Okay, now, you could do this. Where you don't leave, where you don't specify the size. But you should never do that. And here's the reason why. The one thing that you need to always keep in mind is you are using Verilog to describe a digital circuit. And you are anticipating that this circuit is going to look like something you have envisioned what the circuit should look like. If you don't specify the size, Verilog assumes that you have 32 bits. You only need 16 bits to represent it. When you specify something as 32 bits, the circuitry gets created to produce 32-bit results, even though you only want to use 16. That's why, even though this is a syntactically correct statement, from a practical standpoint, you'd never do that. If you envision whatever circuitry is operating on this to be 16 bits, then specify it as 16 bits. Don't assume anything. You tell the synthesizer what you want. Don't let the synthesizer try and figure out what you intended.
Okay.
Now.
I have a question about, if you do decimal, right? How do you specify, do you just have to write the number of bits that are the maximum it can possibly take, whatever
yes.
you're writing?
Okay. For decimal, it depend. Well, you're only gonna need 4 bits, right? Because each character is going to be 0 through 9, and that only takes 4 bits. So decimal and hex would have the same size in that regard. Your text does discuss a little bit about signed and unsigned numbers. I was somewhat amiss as trying to figure out a use for signed numbers other than an adder circuit. But let me stick on the... binary sequence. What are the possible values for a binary variable A that's 1 bit? What are the possible values it can have? 0 and 1, is that it?
Could it be in a metastable state?
What?
Is metastable a possibility?
No. In fact, I'm talking about legitimate values.
Do you need value to interpret it? Like if you're
reading too much into this. How many possible values are there?
It could be a known.
What about?
That's what base zero.
Don't care? What about high impedance? We're talking digital circuits here, right? So X is a don't care, and Z is a high impedance. So you could do that, and that's perfectly legit. So I'm telling you that the least significant bit is high impedance, and the second, third least significant bit is don't care, and the rest of the bits have assigned values of 0 and 1. And you could do that. Now, I could do this. So I've got, how many have I got here, 12? So I could do that, but that's not very readable. It's a lot more readable if I could do this, which I can't. I can use underbars to separate it into blocks. And this is a lot more readable than that is. The syntax, the Verilog compiler will ignore those when it's actually manipulating them. But, and you can put those wherever you want to in that string to break it up and make it a little more readable. Yeah.
So with the X and Z, if I'm not doing a binary number, but I only want to make one bit an X or a Z? Is that not possible? Like if I was doing a long number and I thought it'd be better to do it in hexadecimal, and then I realize, oh, but one of these things I want to be a high impedance and
four bits.
I'm not sure I followed that. Say it again.
So like you have that number at the top, the 7 bits binary number.
This one, yeah.
If you were working on a larger number and you had planned it out to do it in hexadecimal, you were already writing it, and then at some point you realized, oh, I need one bit in this to be high impedance, but not a group of 4 bits to be high impedance. Is there a way to actually?
You wouldn't be using hexadecimal.
Then you just can't.
Unless the entire hexadecimal character itself is high impedance.
Okay. And then that would also mean that you couldn't like have a halfway between high impedance and 4 characters.
No, it's either hexadecimal or binary. It's not, you can't.
Yeah.
Okay. There's no hybrids. A bit later on in the course, I'm going to be talking about test benches, which are Verilog programs that are written as part of the input to a simulator to provide test patterns for the testing circuit. It turns out that in those test benches, it's sometimes useful to be able to print something on standard out on the screen. And so you need the capability of doing strings. And Verilog does provide that capability. And that's with the double quotes on either side, and that's defining a string. So if you wanted to find a string variable, you could do it that way. Identifiers and keywords.
Are you completely on the screen? Just trying to.
I will always look at the screen, okay, and adjust it accordingly. Trust me. When we're talking about identifiers and keywords, they're variable names. And these variable names have certain rules. Any variable that you have must start with either a letter or an underbar. Recall that in the alphabet you have pound signs, semicolons, periods. You can't use any of those characters to start a variable. So your identifiers can have a underbar, or they can't have letters, but no numbers and none of those other special characters. Like everything, there is an exception, and the exception here is the dollar sign. That's reserved for system tasks. And we'll be talking about system tasks at various points in this course, but I'll give you a simple example. Dollar sign finish, that's a system task. And what this does is it terminates the simulation. There's another one, dollar sign display, which is equivalent to a printf statement in C. So there are some system tasks in there. And you can always identify a system task because it has a dollar sign. And these system tasks are all predefined. Let's talk a little bit about data types. All right, from before we had the value set. Oh, incidentally, I want to make one other statement. Back on this sheet here. Verilog is a case-sensitive language. So if I have a variable capital A, it's not the same as a lowercase a, because there are different cases. Okay, so we know for data types we have the value set, 0, 1, don't care, and high impedance. So I need to define this term net because this is the first data type that we're going to be looking at. The net is an interconnection between hardware elements. And there are certain keywords. I never said anything about keywords today.
No.
Let me discuss keywords, and then I'll come back to this slide. So this will still be in your notes. So. Put it aside here for a moment. Let me insert in here keywords. Keywords are variable names that are reserved by the language. That means you can't use them for variable names when you describe your design. Okay. And Verilog has a number of keywords that just like any other language. And in fact, we've got an example. This one here. We have module and end module. Those are keywords. You can't use them for variable names. And there's a lot of other keywords. We had that system task $finish. Finish is a keyword. Can't use it. And I'll make a note here. Lowercase. Okay. Back to nets. There are certain keywords associated with net variables. And there's a whole bunch of them, and you'll see them identified in the text. Wire, WAND, for, short for wired and, WARS, short for wired or, and so on. The wire is the most commonly used net type variable declaration. So if I have the following, I have this keyword wire, and then I have variable a comma y terminated by a semicolon. I have now declared capital A variable name and lowercase y variable names as net type variables. So this is analogous in C. For example, I could have float x comma y. I've declared x and y as float variables. This keyword defines those variables as wire. Or as net type variables. You could put these on separate lines, but if you're gonna declare more than one variable in the same line, you have to separate them with commas. And just like in C, you terminate all statements with a semicolon. The other data type, register variables. Now, register in here does not have the same context as what we discussed in 172. A register variable does not mean it's somehow implemented as a flip-flop. A register variable can hold a value. Register. Holds or stores a value. Now, you may say, well, on the previous slide, we declared a net variable. Can't they hold values too? Not in variable. A wire variable is a variable that gets a value because something is driving that variable. For example, the output of a logic gate. The output of a logic gate will always have a value. Could be zero, could be one, could be don't care, could be high impedance. But the output of a gate will have one of those four values. If I have declared the output of that gate as a wire variable, then it gets its value from the output of the gate, not because you assigned it some value. Register variables, you actually assign them a value with an equals statement. A equals zero. A now holds the value of zero. There's not a device that is driving whatever you've declared A to be in your circuit. Okay, and we'll get into this a little bit more when we start talking about the data flow level of abstraction, which we won't get to until probably next week. Now, when it comes to wire or net type variables or register variables, I may want them to be more than one bit. And here's what I mean. So there's a keyword reg, and I've now declared A as a reg variable. But A is only going to be one bit. Let's suppose that I want to define a variable, let's call it bus, and I want that to be a 8-bit bus. Zoom in on this syntax. You'll see you have square brackets. These are square brackets, not parentheses. And there's a number, a colon, and another number. The number preceding the colon is the number that you're using to designate the most significant bit. The number that you have after the colon is what you're designating as the least significant bit. So I've got bus 0 through bus 7. Bus 0 being the least significant bit, bus 7 being the most significant. If I have square brackets here and just one number, what I'm doing is just extracting the fifth bit. But when I declare it, that's how I declare it. Yeah.
If we wanted to, can we declare it as reg square bracket 0 colon 7?
You can. There's nothing that prevents you from doing that, but the convention is
yes.
Zero is the least significant bit.
Okay.
So what he was asking is, could I declare this as reg 0:7? Yeah. Actually, Verilog will allow you to do reg equals 6:-1 if you want to. Verilog will accept that. Yes.
What would be the utility of starting from an index other than 0? Like, would there be any use for doing reg 15:8?
Could be. But the convention is that 0 is the least significant bit. I mean, if you look at, like, memory chips, when they define the address bus lines and the data bus lines, shows the least significant bit.
So let's say we flip them. Let's say we define 0:7. Will that 0 index, this is basically an array of buses, right, of lines. Will that 0 still be the most significant bus? You see what I mean?
No.
Because in the book, they still say that even if you flip those, like, let's say you declare 0:7.
Oh, this is the number that you're using, and all the intervening numbers go up from there. If I have reg 0:4t, so it depends on how you want to do it. I've always written my Verilog code this way, where I use 0 as the least significant bit. If you use the keyword integer, it's 32 bits. If you don't want C to be 32 bits wide, you want it to be something smaller, declare it as something smaller using that notation that we did before. Incidentally, that notation that I had with the square brackets, that can be used for both wired and reg declarations, either one. But if you use integer, it's going to turn out to be 32 bits by default.
Is integer a type of reg?
Yes. The other one is you could have you can declare variables as real, and in that particular case, I would have something like let's say I declared A to be a real variable, and in the program I could write A equals 4E10, which says that A is equal to 4 times 10 to the 10th power. Of course, in digital circuits, you're not going to see the real declaration used all that often.
Okay. How does it implement that? Like, if you tell
say
it,
again?
How does it implement that? Like, if you tell us it.
I'm not going to worry about implementation now.
Okay.
Later on in the course, after we finish Verilog, I'm going to go through some examples and show you certain syntax And if it was going to be implemented, not in an FPGA, but in an ASIC where you would have individual gates, I'm gonna show you the type of circuitry that you would get for a given type of syntax. And some of it is actually kind of surprising, most notably shift registers on what you get. Let's take a 10-minute break.
I'm gonna keep going, so I wanna like figure out how to slice together two videos.
Yeah,
I just wanna just pull this off my phone and upload it to YouTube.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, on his test, for 2 seconds, it was all
in the books. Alright, yeah, I'm just gonna go back through this. I don't know. Well, this is actually.
You can watch the video on this?
Yeah, no, it's a lot of review, especially if you log it all the time.
I'm gonna leave that going. Also, I'm gonna talk to people about what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like my first edition is going to
so
maybe I'll
see him.
That's not the one.
As I told him, you're not going to say that. I don't know what the difference is.
Oh, yeah. Unless you're getting it out. That's cool.
If I go to, well, like this here, this is example 713. That may not be example 713. So the only danger associated with this is when I go through an example, I don't know if the examples are changed. And that's what I'm saying. You know, if you want to use it, it's fine. Typically, they've been.
Before you
Now, if I create a folder that's like useful programs, and then I underneath that in like GCC, which like folder that has all of the GNU, and then I have like my shit, like, will I need a separate path for both of these, or can I tell it to look in all the subfolders?
This is
this is really bad because I can't do the screen without more time. Yeah, well, I figure that, like, I could probably upload it to YouTube from my phone and then delete it. Also, it'll probably take like 10 gigs. I have a lot of space on my phone. 10 gigs a lot on my phone. So, upload it, delete it, every spot. Are you post-doc? Okay, you're doing the math. Okay, I mean, oh, you're actually taking class over now. That's awesome.
Well, also, it's like,
I mean, I know that you, but like, because programming languages is like, yes, once you get into like, you know, templates, you know, all this inheritance from that like, it's more understanding how to design something. It's really, it's like, you know, with an artist, it's easy to understand how a pen works, but it doesn't
I'll be in the fall. So you pretty much just told me I was going to teach a high school and like gave me 6 courses to do, like 2 or 2.
Yes. Thailand, Japan. I'm an idiot. Came back and was like, I like computers. So.
Where'd you do your algebra?
My famous rod.
Okay. Yeah, I know this is my like 6 year of college,
but
I didn't have my master's this year. I'm
so tired. You spent all your time just like in classes. In Thailand, they were like pretty much like 50.
Yeah, but they were taking classes.
But it's like 50 to 100 years.
Oh, well, no, but like this is college.
Yeah.
If somebody like stood up and started shouting, it's just not a class.
My like, I was teaching seventh grade to seniors in high school. It's a little different.
Yeah.
Class size matters a little more.
Okay. Let's suppose I made the following rate variable declarations. Rate Y is one bit variable. A is a 8-bit variable. B is a 3-bit variable. So let's suppose I write that. So I'll give A an 8-bit value. If I do that, what I am doing is I'm just extracting out bits 2, 3, and 4. So that's 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. B would have a value of 1, 1, 1. Y would have a value of 0. So everybody see that? So you can use this notation here to extract a portion of the of a variable. Okay, now you can expand on this just a little bit. And you notice I've got this square bracket notation, and you interpret this the same way. The semantics are the same. Bit position of most significant bit position numbering of the least significant bit. But you notice I have it on both sides of a variable. to be a 4K by 8 memory declaration. I've got whatever variable name, I chose ROM, you can pick anything. We can pick X, let's say XYZ, doesn't have to be ROM or RAM or whatever. There's 4K of them, and each one is 8 bits wide. So that's how I would declare a 4K by 8 memory in Verilog. Is that clear? We see how that works? Okay.
And Verilog wouldn't understand if we wanted to use, like, if we wanted to actually write 4K, and it would understand that it was a binary value.
No, you got to put in the number. If you write 4K, unless you somehow declared in a parameter statement or something that 4K equals 4,095, it's not going to understand it.
And I couldn't, and there's no way to like write 2 to the power of something.
There is, but we're not there yet.
We're not there.
Parameters. This allows you to define constants at compile time. Since they're defined at compile time, program statements can't change them. So let's suppose I did this, and I'm going to use your example that you just brought up on the memory. Do that. So using that parameter, which is a keyword, and I say byte equals 8, parameter 4K equals 4,095. Program statements cannot change the value of byte and 4K. If you want to change that to something else, you will have to edit the file and recompile it. So since I have those variable names defined now, I can actually have a mathematical expression there. I can declare XYZ to be a reg variable of byte minus 1, that would be 7:0. And it's 4K:0. There's 4K of them. I've defined 4K as 4,095. Okay. So you can do that. Yes.
So when we're declaring a parameter, it the number format is now different than the like one bit.
Well, usually when you use parameter statements, they're typically you could use that tick mark value if you want to, but using real values is easy because this is a typical example of where you want to do things.
Yeah.
Let's suppose that I have defined, for example. a design for a 4-bit binary counter. Now I could hard code in the number 4 in the code, or I could use a parameter statement, and if I wanted to use that same code to get a 6-bit binary counter, I could just edit the one line to change the parameter from 4 to 8, recompile the program, and I'm done. There's something called instance parameter override, which we will get to far later in the course, which is an easier way of doing it. But where these parameter statements are quite often used is in situations like this, where you're making a bunch of declarations, and if you need to use this code for something else, rather than going in and editing every line, I could just edit the one parameter line and recompile it, and everything gets changed for me. So the parameter statements are quite useful. We already talked about strings. We mentioned system tasks. I'm going to show you a system task. This is on page 41 of the text, which you might find useful when you write test benches, where you're writing a Verilog program to generate test patterns for testing. This is example 3-3 in the text. Dollar sign says it's a system task. There's a keyword display. Hello, Verilog world. And that's a string variable, so it's in quotes. And that's what prints out of the standard out. There's another one called time. And what the system task time does is it returns the current time since a simulation started. And so what this would do is this would print on standard out what the current simulation time is. So those are examples. The syntax for this statement here is identical to what you find in the printf statement for C programs. In fact, this system task display is equivalent to printf in C, because you can use all of these characters if you want to print out variable names. You also have the forward slash or the backslash n for new line, slash for tab, all of that stuff works in Verilog as well in this display system task. Compiler directives. There are a number of compiler directives. The one that you will find most useful is the following. Okay, so compiler directives are instructions to the compiler in other programming languages. It does not convert into executable code. In Verilog, they do not synthesize into some sort. They're instructions to the compiler. I'll give you the most common one that you're going to use. In C, if I wanted to include file.h, I'd use dollar sign, or I'm sorry, pound sign include, and then the file. In Verilog, it's that one, the backward tick mark. So if I do that, if I had a file that's got a bunch of Verilog modules that I want to include in my design, and I got them in a separate file, this is how you would tell the compiler you need to include this file as well as part of the design. Okay, but that is the backward tick mark. Okay. Now, I had previously made the statement that modules are the basic building block of Verilog programs. And this figure, which is figure 4-1 in the text, shows you the major components that you will find in a Verilog module. And then we'll look at a specific example so that we can see what these components are. You have a header, the body, and then a footer. In the header, you will have the module name. All modules have to have a name, and normally that name is descriptive. If I'm building a binary counter that's 6 bits, maybe I choose as the module name binary 6 count. Choose anything you want to, but usually it's descriptive in nature. The port list and the port declarations, those define what are the names of the signals that come into and what are the signal names for signals that go out of that particular module. And their declarations, because you have to declare them then, is whether they're inputs or outputs, whether they're rates, whether they're nets. What are they? And any parameter statements. So then, well, I guess the declarations are in the body. In the body, you will have declarations. You could have data flow statements if you're doing a data flow description of the circuit. Always in initial blocks if you're doing a behavior level description. Task and functions, and instantiation of any lower modules. And then the footer just has the keyword and module. So let's look at an example. Here's a set reset latch built out of NAND gates. So the set input I'm going to call S bar, the reset input R bar, and the outputs Q and Q bar, complementary outputs. This is a gate level description of that particular circuit, and when we get to gate level, this will make a lot more sense. And my objective here is not to go through and explain the syntax of this, but merely to point out the different components. So there's the keyword module, the module name, which is SR underbar latch. This is the port list where I have defined the 4 signals that are inputs and outputs. do you see Q, Q bar, S bar, R bar? S bar, R bar, Q, and Q bar. There's the declarations. I've told you the Q and Q bar are outputs. I've told you that S bar and R bar are inputs. I've then got some code that describes the design. And then there's the footer and module. So this is a synthesizable module and it's got the components. Now, the components that you saw in this diagram are not necessarily present in every design that you do. If I'm doing a data flow level of abstraction design, I'm not going to have any behavioral statements, so that block isn't in there. I may or may not have tasks and functions defined. So these are present depending on what you're actually doing. But they are possible of being in the design. I want to show you this particular example because it's got a very important principle here. The port declarations, like I said, the ports are the input and outputs to the particular module. And here, this is supposedly for a D flip-flop. I've got a Q, a D, a clock, and a reset. And these are separated by commas. And then the statement is terminated by a semicolon. Just looking at that statement, you don't know what are inputs and what are outputs. The declarations will tell you that. This tells you that the Q in the port list is an output. If Q is a reg variable, you have to redeclare it. Notice the redeclaration. You say it's an output, and then you redeclare it as a reg variable. If you do not do the redeclaration, Verilog assumes it's a net type variable. Input and output declarations are by default wire variables unless you redeclare them. Okay. Now, a couple points here. You have to watch the size when you redeclare. For example, say I have a module called Shelly, and I've got A and B in my port list. And I say that what does that statement do?
Turns A to output of four different.
Is it just an output?
It's four different outputs.
Four bit.
It's a 4-bit output, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a size declaration. That's wrong. A was not declared as a 1-bit variable, it was declared as 4 bits. That's the correct way to do the redeclaration. When you redeclare, the size has got to match the original declaration. Invariably, everybody does this. The first time you do this, you'll declare something to be so many bits wide. You do a redeclaration, you forget to put the size in. The size of the redeclaration has to match the original declaration.
Okay. Will it give you an error if you do that? Or
you get an error. It'll, as a matter of fact, it's probably going to be an error, not a warning. I did want to point this out there. You can do the ANSI C syntax, where in the port list you do your declaration in the port list and a redeclaration in the port list. So this would be equivalent to declaring sum to be a 4-bit variable and then doing a second statement on the redeclaration. So these two are equivalent to doing that down here, outside of the port list. I prefer, and this is my own personal preference, I prefer not to do this NCC. To me, it's a lot easier to keep things straight, because when I do something like this, I can put comments in there. I can say, well, this is an output. What is that output representing on this module? And I can put that in the comment statement and then do my redeclaration. So I prefer not using the NCC, but that's a personal preference.
Yeah. Whatever you wrote on the page there, I couldn't see it.
It's on the notes.
Thanks.
Now, this is a very important figure. Figure 4-4. These are the port connection rules. It's common in, unless you've got a trivial Verilog design that you're trying to do, you're going to have a series of modules, and some modules are going to be instantiated in other modules. We saw an example of that where we had that ripple carry counter and we instantiated in there T flip-flops. And the T flip-flops were described in a module template that was XML. So I'm going to have modules instantiated in my design and I'm going to have to connect to them. And you do that through the port list. You got to make sure the declarations match. What these port connection rules say is your output signal can be declared as a rect variable or a net variable, a wire. And remember, input and output are by default net type variables. So I could have a net type variable or a reg variable as my output declaration for this particular module. If this is driving another module, whatever it's driving had to have been declared as a net type variable. My inputs are always net type variables. They can be driven by a reg or a net type signal from another module. So I have input declarations, I have output declarations. There's also something called in-out. I-N-O-U-T, keyword, which says that that particular signal is bidirectional. And in out is just like input and output. By default, it is a net type variable. And whatever is driving that and whatever signal that drives must be net type variables. There's an example here in the text showing you illegal port connections. So I've got this module called top, and here I've declared some 4-bit and 1-bit ports. Cout is a wire. It's a net type variable. And now I'm going to instantiate this module full add, and I'm going to hook these signals up to this module here. And you'll find out that I have violated rules, and the problem is the sum is declared as a net variable, and it doesn't match because here in this module it was declared as a reg variable, which means that this output from the module is always supposed to drive a net type variable. It's driving a reg type variable. You get a compiler error if you try and do that. Now, there are two ways that you can get two modules to communicate with each other. The first way, which is an example 7-4, is connection by order. Okay, so here I have a module, and here I have a module template. And this module is instantiated in this module. You'll notice you have module and module, module and module. So those are two separate modules. This one is instantiated in this one. How do I know that? Well, you notice this name in the module template is full add 4. Matches the name. Just like in C, if I called a subroutine foo and I want to execute in the main routine, I have to use that same name, foo. Same thing here. When you instantiate one module in another one, whatever module name you used in the module template is the name you have to use in the module you instantiated. So now, this is a module template, so you can think of these as dummy names. Just like in C, if I write a subroutine, I pick dummy names for the inputs and outputs of the subroutine. Same thing here in the module template. These are just dummy names. In the module where I'm going to instantiate it, those are the real signal names I want to use. So I've got to match the real signals that were declared here with these dummies. Well, this is a full adder. What does a full adder do? It takes two numbers that are so many bits wide, plus a carry in, and produces an output and a carry out. So I have sum, carry out, A, B, and carry in. It's a 4-bit sum. Carry out is 1 bit. The two inputs, A and B, are 4 bits wide, and the carry in is 1 bit. Connection by order. In the modules where I am instantiating this module template, whatever signal names I'm using, and you notice these are all uppercase, that was just the choice that the author used. That's how you marry them up 1-to-1. It's just like in C. If I have a C routine, where I have float, foo, float x, int k, and then down here in my main routine, I have y equals foo 2.2, 6. The 2.2 gets matched up with that. The 6 gets matched up with that. It's order based. Same thing here. Okay. So everybody understand the order based. That's how you marry up signals between two modules by matching the order. So you got to refer to the module template to see what order those are in. The preferred method. And this is my preference, and therefore it should be your preference, is something called connection by name. Okay? Now, I duplicated this module template from the previous slide. Okay? See this? Sum, C out, A, B, and C out. Same as before. Look at the connection by name. I have dot, C out, and then a variable name in parentheses. Dot, a variable name, and something else in parentheses. If you notice, the dot variable name, those are the same ones that were used in the module template. What I put in parentheses is in the module that I'm instantiating in, what the signal names are. That's how I marry up the signal names, is dot the module template name, and this is the name in the module I instantiated in. Now here's why I say this is preferable. It's preferable for two reasons, and I want you to get in the habit of using connection by name rather than connection by order. Let's suppose I have a design that has 27 port signals. You gonna keep that order straight for all 27 signals? That may be difficult to do. And the last thing you need is to screw something up for some stupid little error, like you did, you swapped two variables in the port list. But here's a more important reason why. Let's suppose that I am working for a company in Portland, and she's working at a company down in Palo Alto, California. She's designing one module, and I'm designing another module. I'm going to instantiate her module into mine. She hasn't finished her design yet. I don't need to know what order she has put all of those signals in the port list. All she has to do is tell me the names. And I can go ahead and write my code. And when I ultimately get her design, I can now incorporate it into mine and start running my simulation and my synthesis, because I'm doing connection by name. I don't care what order she used. It doesn't matter. I'll get the right connections. And that's why I prefer the connection by name, is I don't need, because here's the important thing, which I didn't state. When you do connection by name, it doesn't matter what order you put these in. I could have done output, input, output, input, output, input. It doesn't matter, because it's connection by name. And that's why, in this case, order doesn't matter when you do connection by name. Yes?
So, just to confirm, the way you do connection by name is dot, the variable name, and then open parenthesis.
The variable name that was used in the module template. Okay. And then in parentheses, the signal name in the module that you instantiated that template in. And that's how you connect them up. And it doesn't matter about the order because it's a one-to-one matching.
Is that parentheses at the end of the .aa? Is that the typo or is it supposed to be there? Or is it
a
comma?
Or see, one, like, yeah, two, three, four, five. Yeah, this is a mistake in the text. That's a mistake. That last comma shouldn't be in there because it's only 5 seconds. Okay? All right. Next Tuesday, we're going to start coding up designs. And what we're going to do is we're going to first deal with gate level designs, which means I'm going to take Verilog code where I know specifically what gates I want to use and how to connect them. And we're going to write a Verilog program that will describe a gate level. Homework will be posted by noon tomorrow. Next Thursday.
So we